Good afternoon. First of all, thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with you on such a relevant issue during today's conference. I'm well aware of several concerns that you have about the Control of the Acquisition and Possession of Weapons Directive, and this after meeting numerous stakeholders, some of which are present today in this conference. It was after these meetings and after studying in greater detail the directive per se and the reasoning behind it that I tabled several amendments in the Civil Liberties, Justice and Home Affairs Committee, of which I am a member, and which committee was an opinion-giving committee precisely on this directive. Now that the directive has progressed further, I can assure you that I will keep on monitoring developments, as most of you already know. As you are all well aware, we are living in a time when our citizens in the EU are feeling increasingly insecure. This is not an opinion, but a state of fact. The European Union, which since its foundation has been described as a successful project for peace, had to deal with terrorist attacks within its own borders just up to a few weeks ago. In 2016 alone, we had repeated shootings in France, Germany and Belgium. We had numerous cases of stabbings in these same countries, as well as in Italy and United Kingdom. We had the attack on the Brussels airport and the infamous truck attack on Berlin Christmas markets. And this situation is not limited to our member states alone. On our European borders, we also have repeated terrorist attacks in Turkey, with the most recent one just a couple of days ago. The world is changing, and we need to adapt for today's realities. This I completely understand, as much as I understand the fact that it is in this climate of instability and insecurity that the European Commission acted and started working on this revision of this directive. We all agree that European citizens deserve the highest standard of security possible. However, this should never come to the detriment of law-abiding citizens, including sport shooting practitioners, museums and collectors of historical arms who contribute greatly to our rich heritage of military history. Nor should it be detrimental to the staging of historical reenactments or the production of action movies involving firearms. We need to find a balance between public safety and the legal use of firearms. One question that remains unanswered until this very day is why the current directive has not been implemented properly by all member states. And that's what the EU should ensure. It should ensure that all member states adhere to the directive properly. The greatest problem which remains today, and which in my opinion will not be addressed properly with what is being currently proposed, is the illegal trade in weapons, and illegal trade of weapons making their way into the EU. I concur that we need a truly comprehensive system that safeguards security and combats trafficking in firearms. But this cannot be successfully achieved if we do not combat the firearms black market as well. It is common knowledge that the dark web exists, and this, together with other technological advances, has facilitated black market trade. I cannot emphasize enough how illegal trade is the root cause of the problem, and thus, yes, it needs to be addressed properly. This is crucial if we want to achieve the right balance between security and our freedoms. In my opinion, combating this illegal trade would be more effective than prohibiting replicas or deactivating cultural and historical weapons as proposed in the Commission's directive. Is banning reenactment weapons the solution to the challenges we are facing? Or are historical weapons kept safely in museums the true problem that we need to deal with? I highly doubt it. Unfortunately, these are all aspects which cast serious doubts on the proposed directive on firearms in Europe. Ultimately, if we are dealing and we want to address properly European security, then we should look further than just regulating legal firearms. In the long list of attacks, which I mentioned earlier, there were several instances where not even one shot was fired, but terrorists found other means to reach the target. But if we are going to regulate further, it is imperative that this is done by truly focusing on the main challenges and root causes of the problem. We simply cannot have a directive which, instead of tackling these issues, punishes law-abiding citizens who are already regulated on a national level. For today, I would leave it there. I wish you all a very fruitful discussion, and I look forward also to the conclusions that you will come up with.